Brew podcast. It's been a long time, but with Battlefield 1 coming out, we are back in the saddle. I am Nozu for you. With me, we've got AOA Bohika, whose identity is so secret, you can't even see who he is.
That's right.
We've got WDA Punisher, and our special guest tonight, we've got Kickstan with us. Kickstan, hello.
Kicks in the house.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Awesome. It's good for you all to be with us. We have a...
Battlefield 1 Ultimate Edition on the PC, and Titanfall 2 Deluxe Edition on the PC. Yep.
But I don't think that hold on a second, I'm getting back feed. I mean, if you played, Battlefront or the visuals in Battlefront were really stunning to me. The improvements they made in the engine there transferred over beautifully to what they were trying to accomplish in Battlefield 1, and I think they nailed it as far as just the visuals of the game. I mean, I don't know that I've played a prettier shooter. Yeah. I definitely think that they hit that out of the park.
Nice. Very good. Paul, what do you think? Pun?
I'm excited with the game. I've had a lot of fun with it. It's definitely a lot different than what we've been used to playing here within the last 3 or 4 years. It's a different challenge, a different way to play. As Bo says, it's absolutely the most beautiful game I've ever played, and the sounds are unbelievable. So it's really awesome. Had a lot of fun with it, especially the campaign. I love the campaign, so I'm really excited with that.
Yeah, I haven't played the campaign yet. The prologue is as far as I get. Honestly, I don't play campaigns much anymore. It's all about multiplayer. But Kickstan, what was the first Battlefield game you played?
1942.
Okay, so you're like probably each one of us here who started out in 42. Yeah, yeah.
I think I didn't start out in 42.
Yeah. I didn't either. I was a BF2 guy. I didn't have a PC when 1942 came out.
I started in 42 on LAN in my college fraternity. We'd all play that and Counter-Strike. But out of all the Battlefields, since you're kind of a supreme veteran here, Kickstan, how do you rate this one so far against everything?
Oh wow, no campaign, pressure.
What campaign wise? Let's talk about campaign.
I haven't touched the campaign.
Okay, so you haven't touched it. You're like me. You haven't touched it either.
No, I went straight to multiplayer. I usually do the campaign like later on when I'm looking to fill in gaps in content.
When the internet goes down.
Exactly.
Yeah. So Paul, did you play it straight through?
Yes. I was fortunate enough to get a press pass to the game, and I took a day and just really concentrated on playing the campaign, going through each of the storylines, it's a lot of fun. I remember when they were initially talking about the campaign right before the game came out, I guess it was about a month and a half ago, and one of the things that I was hoping was that it was going to be story-based, that it was going to focus on different people, and lo and behold, that's what we got, so I was really excited for that.
Now you said that's probably one of the best campaigns that you've ever played, or you tweeted
and
that.
Kind of renege on that real quick.
Yeah, I know, because I brought up Half-Life and kind of jumped on you, which to your defense, you had to play.
It's the best shooter campaign that I have ever played. Now, I've only played Ghost Recon, the Call of Duty franchise, the Battlefield, and I'm trying to think what other shooters, Overwatch, but that doesn't have a campaign. I'm trying to think of campaign shooters. Yeah, I mean, that's really about it for shooters. I don't have it's a fantastic campaign. It's the best one Battlefield's ever done. I will say that. I will put my reputation on the line and say that it's the best one that Battlefield has done.
Wow.
And that's a lot, because I enjoyed the Bad Company. Well, I enjoyed the Bad Company 2 campaign. I really liked it a lot, too. But there's a side of it to me that goes beyond just the fact that it's a campaign for a video game, because you can relate to this, with the military background, with my love for history, I look at it maybe in a little different light than some people would. And I look at it as a just kind of, I don't know, because like, well, with the opening prequel to the stories, I mean, you're seeing all this action and the fighting and the carnage going on, the brutality of war, and then you have these two guys face each other at the end, and they're just guys fighting for their own country. They're fighting for their same ideal, just for different countries, and they realize at the end that it's just not worth it, or it's just that, what's another death going to do, and they stop. And I was just that kind of made me reflect a little bit, and it made me kind of look at it in a different light than just a video game campaign, because I was like, wow, this is probably how they were really thinking in World War One. And I kind of think that's how DICE was trying to go for.
Yeah, they're trying to aim for the whole fruitlessness of war type of thing. Almost anti-war in a way, which, not saying that in a bad way, but just kind of showing the pointlessness that was World War One. Mm. Very, very cool. Let's move right on to multiplayer, the thing that people really, really care about. So I want to start talking about the launch. Kickstand, was this launch successful? What do you think about that?
It was one of the best launches. Anyone that played Battlefield 3, Battlefield 4, Battlefield, obviously, everyone that played Battlefield 4 knows how much of a shit show that was. But I honestly didn't have any major problems. It was one of the cleanest EA DICE launches I've had in a long, long time.
Has anyone had problems yet? I mean, aside from a couple game crashes when you exit a game, you kind of get that hang up, which I think they patched even. Mm-hmm. I thought it ran perfectly smooth. I didn't have any issues getting into a game, no excessive wait. So from my perspective, I think everything about this launch, DICE really learned what went wrong from the last one. And go ahead, Bo.
And you can actually, that's actually, a point I kind of wanted to make. If everybody remembers, after Battlefield 4, EA specifically came out and talked about, if you're under leadership, most of you guys, through your job, management training, leadership, people talk culture change. And you remember, Pond, you and I and Chris and Sean had talked about the article that came out where they were talking about the culture change that they wanted to implement throughout EA.
It kind of started when Peter Moore came on board.
So I really think that when you look back, I don't want to pile on, Battlefield 4, right? But if Battlefield 4 was the demarcation point of where they wanted to get better from, every launch since then has been good for them. Mm-hmm, Hardline had a pretty good launch. I mean, there were some gameplay-related issues, I think, with the community, but overall, the game ran fine. Battlefront was a smooth launch, and then Battlefield 1 has just... I mean, I play on two platforms, and I have not had any issues near the volume that I had, with previous releases. So... I mean, I think this idea of a culture change definitely is working for them.
Yeah.
Oh, I will pile on to Battlefield 4. Why be shy? It was an absolute steaming mess. And
yes,
a lot of people forget that Battlefield 3 had its issues too when that came out. That was not smooth either. So this is really recovering off of years and years of issues. So good on DICE for fixing those issues and ensuring that the release went smooth. So I guess we can all go ahead.
I was just going to say, I mean, it really plays through, you know, I know you have different sides of the community that view involvement with either EA or the community managers. But I'll tell you right now, the community managers they have, and I'm not just saying this because they potentially are watching or whatever, but I mean, the communication from those people to the community is much better.
Absolutely.
In my opinion. And that's helped.
They're accessible.
I was going to say, I don't even know if you can stop at the community managers. I think DICE, period, like from top to bottom.
Right.
They're one of the only like game developers and community managers and anybody else that's behind a game that's as popular as Battlefield. And you can tweet them and there's a 90% chance they're going to get back to you.
Yep.
I mean, if you're talking to them like an adult, respectful, and have intelligent questions or intelligent feedback.
Right.
If you follow Julian or any of those other guys, you see these huge long strings where they're just going back with feedback from community members these are EA employees too, so you got to remember that.
To balance EA out the conversation, I mean, you know, there are things, you know, when we talk about the pluses and minuses, I mean, I think I had a tweet there after the beta. I was not real happy with some of the balancing in the beta, right? And so I kept watching people talk about stuff that they didn't like about the beta, and the standard answer was, we'll put it in the forum. And that was a great answer, and I think they did a great job of compiling it there. As someone on the outside looking in, I would love to have seen, okay, from the beta, these are the common issues that everyone complained about. Like, here's a list, right? Like, I never saw that. So when you release the game, I never had a reference point to go back to. I mean, expecting people to go back and look at through threads of like, hey, was this already reported? Or I would like to have seen something compiled there. But I mean, when you start getting into some of that communication at that level, I mean, it just shows how big the change in conversation has been between Battlefield 4 to Battlefield 1, right?
Yeah,
absolutely. No, I agree.
Another thing too that I want to bring on that kind of goes along with that too is this is the second time that we've seen all of the studios with EA, with it, DICE Sweden, DICE LA, and Visceral, that have combined to do the co-develop a game. And so the first game was Battlefield Hardline, which turned out fantastic on launch. And then the second game is, the second game would actually be Star Wars Battlefront, because I think LA and DICE Sweden had their hand in that together. Mm-hmm. And then now I guess the third game would be Battlefield 1. And in terms of stability and smoothness, all three of those games came out really strong on launch.
Yeah, and I want to put a pin in that collaborative programming thought. Because I think that there's some issues in this game when we start talking about the likes, don't likes, that we need to circle back to that comment.
Yeah.
Because yeah. I think for console people especially, it's gonna that's an important thing.
Definitely. So next topic, and before we move on to that, Kickstand, someone's already pointed out that they recognize your foundation beer.
Actually, winning. I'm actually wearing my Bissell shirt too. So.
We've got some beer connoisseurs out there. Very nice, very nice. So let's talk about overall gameplay. And when I mean this, let's talk about just, you know, kind of every component to that. Smoothness, player movement, graphics, servers, just everything that makes the actual mechanical experience of gameplay. So, Paul, let's start with you on this. What okay. do you think overall?
I guess in terms of movement, I'm pretty happy with that, actually. The speed is fine. I'm happy with the speed. One of the things that they haven't implemented with Battlefield 1 that's been in the previous Battlefields is different speeds based on the weapons you're carrying. Like, for instance, you know, usually a lot of people switch to their pistol to run faster.
To run faster, yep. Yeah. I missed that a lot. And
that's not in BF1. I don't know if that's necessarily a big deal. It's just something that's different. As far as the obstacles and climbing over things go, they have cleaned that up a whole lot from what the beta was. A lot of those ledges and you know, little 2-foot ledges and stuff that we couldn't even climb over in the beta now work. So I'm happy with that. The one thing I'm not happy with in terms of movement and you know crouching, that sort of thing, is it happens to me a lot. is when I'm crouched by a wall or an object that you could climb over, when I come up from crouch, it automatically climbs me over that wall. Drives me absolutely crazy. Mm-hmm. And but I mean, yeah, overall, I mean, I think everything's smooth. I like how everything moves right. The planes feel right. The horses feel right. Running the tanks all.
Which that's not an easy thing to do too. I can't think of a single game right now, or at least multiplayer first person shooter type that has horses in it. No. I mean, I'm sure there's some medieval games, but horse mechanics and realistic movements and all that. It's not the easiest thing in the world. I think they did a really good job with that. Yeah. Kickstan, what do you think? How do you think this fits in with Battlefield 4 and Battlefield 3? Do you think they improved? Do you think it's kind of the same, work in progress? Do you see the areas that they can improve on?
I think they kind of built on a lot of this stuff that they did with Hardline. It's weird. Every Battlefield's like a cousin of the other one. They're not exactly related. They have bits and pieces that are the same from the previous, but they don't. You know, you think with games like this, you take the core and you add one little thing or two little things. Each new Battlefield has been a drastic departure from the previous. I was really happy with it. I was with Pun. I was really worried. Anyone that tried to climb on anything near Objective Butter on the Alpha map, you got stuck on everything. And I was like, oh, here we go again. You're just slamming the space bar, swearing at your monitor, getting shot in the back. But I love the movement. I love that there's a ridiculous amount of flanking routes now, because you can jump over almost any wall, any object. It's very fluid. It's not real herky-jerky. I've run into that bug that you've mentioned as well, Pun, when you're crouching behind a wall and you spacebar and it just climbs you over the damn thing. But all in all, I think it's the best. As far as player movement's concerned, it's the best Battlefield I played in that aspect. Anyone that played like 2 or 2142, now that those are free to play, and going back and playing those after these Battlefields, and you realize how clunky those games were compared to where we're at now. We're really spoiled.
Especially with movement.
It's funny that you bring up Hardline, and Bo, I know you absolutely love Hardline. A lot of us do.
Yeah, the gunplay in Hardline is the best Battlefield gunplay.
And that's why I wanted to bring this up, especially with movements. Do you feel that the movements are similar to Hardline, or do you kind of wish they might have collaborated more with Visceral in these type of things? Do you have the feeling that they did, or are they kind of lacking?
So, you know, knowing that Frostbite's always built iteration after iteration, right? So whatever was cleaned up and improved upon with Hardline fell over to Battlefront. Battlefront, obviously, really to me, was the feeder for this game. Not necessarily the gunplay mechanics, but just visually the backbone, absolutely, the net code of that, right? I do think PC-wise, the gunplay feels a lot like Hardline on PC. I can't say the same for console. And Pawn hit the nail on the head a couple of days ago with his tweet. When you talk to console players and then you talk to PC players, I think, seem a little more happy with Battlefield 1 right now than console players. Console players, it there's just a little bit of a hitch in the giddy up they need to fix with some of the weapon balance, the gunplay. They need to build, and I don't know if they did, so, you know, I might just be talking out my ass here, right? But it feels like they didn't do what Hardline did, and that separate the weapons profiles for being one for console, one for PC. And to me, that's when Hardline really hit its stride, was after they made that change. A lot of people were happier with that game.
It's funny because, you know, you talk about your woes that you have on PlayStation 4, and I hear a lot of console players echoing the same thing, that it's just one big sniper fest. But honestly, I probably only got about 20-something hours in it at this point. I know, Paul, you probably got a lot more, but I don't notice the snipers as badly in PC. I'm not spawning and getting shot right away by snipers. Usually what's happening is I'm spawning in an airplane, the pilot's crashing immediately. That's my bad luck. But I get killed a lot by recon, but not any more than any other class. So
I'll tell you to me what exacerbates the sniper thing, right? And I didn't really put two and two together in the beta. And once you get some of the tips and hints and stuff when you're playing the release game, when you spawn into an objective, it spawns you in the open.
Yeah.
So that just, to me, exacerbates some of the sniping issues because it's like, oh, a fresh target. Nowhere to run. I mean, especially on Saint Scar or whatever, I mean, you'll be right in the middle of a field and just spawn in. So I definitely think the spawn system needs a little bit of work.
Well, spawning has always been an issue, though, because I remember Hardline went through an issue where the spawns were horrendous.
Atrocious.
But they fixed that, especially on Team Deathmatch, and I think it was a lot better when they did.
Right. So I mean, I definitely think the spawns play into some of that why the sniping feels so weird. I have a different take on the sniping. I'm okay if they never nerf the snipers, and I'm not a sniper. But if you're gonna nerf the sniper, or if you're gonna leave the snipers the same, then they need to buff some of the other classes. The LMGs to me are supremely unpowered.
Yeah,
they shoot potatoes, man.
I'm sure that'll be a very, very good discussion when we get there. And you know what my answer is to snipers, a little airburst mortar action, which I probably have more kills with airburst than any other weapon, right?
But I think you guys are going to find, especially, in Kickstand, I'm not sure if you're mostly a PC or console player, but I mean, I'll tell you, just speaking for the console guys here in chat, that's probably where your bigger gripes are right now on console, some of the weapon balance.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, so I want to talk about maps right now, and I'll kick this off because my views are probably going to be a lot different than your views on this. And I don't want to sound like I don't like the maps. I think they're gorgeous. They put so much detail into these maps. I mean, they're phenomenal. But from my perspective, and this is an issue I think they had in Battlefield 4, They're just lacking some of the stuff that Battlefield 3 and prior maps had. Like you don't have your Damavan Peaks, you don't have your Karkins, you don't have your Karg Islands. There's no distinguishing features on some of the maps, maybe except for my favorite match, which right now is probably Omnion, which to me feels a lot like Sen. You've got that railroad track going through the middle and that center area where awesome intense firefights happen, and really, that's the only map I can think of. The maps are really
Amiens good. Amiens probably one of my favorites. Ballroom Blitz, man.
Well, Ballroom Blitz has a lot of cool things. You got that train station down at the end where a lot of cool separate firefights happen. But I think for me, maybe just some the maps are huge for the most part. Maybe scaling some of them back a little. I don't know. What do you all think, Kickstand? Let's start with you. What do you think about the maps?
I agree that there's especially the desert maps, there's a total lack of cover going from objective to objective, except for a couple sand dunes. But like San Quentin Scar is one of the best maps. I think it's probably in my top 5 or 6 in Battlefield period. I just love the way that map plays. What's the one that everyone loves? That's kind of like Sign Crossing. That's an instant classic.
Amiens.
Yeah, Amiens.
And Ballroom Blitz, those are probably my 3 favorite right now. But those all have different parts of the map that can play differently. You can either have your urban combat. There's a lot of separate places where there's long lines of sight. You have building to building combat. It's those maps. San Quentin does the same thing. It has a lot of different separate things that make. I'm trying to say that they all have my favorite pieces of combat in each map, in different parts of the map.
Yeah.
And especially, I really like the flag flow in San Quentin. Like, it feels like no matter what, you're only, like, 5 seconds away from another flag. Even though it's a big map, you're always close to a flag.
And there's always action on San Quentin.
And this is a very good point. And maybe part of what I'm feeling is just the lack of vehicles, at least on the tank side of things, because in Battlefield's past, you've got like 3 or 4 tanks spawning almost to the point in Battlefield 3. There were some maps. What was the name of the oil field map?
Firestorm.
You have Firestorm where you would have tanks that would go untouched and people would just do their own thing. And I think maybe it would be cool to have some maps where there's just more than one tank spawning, so you get some different action in there going on. So maybe that's the solution.
a map like Monte Grappa, that map's almost too big. Mm-hmm. That map is massive.
It's massive, yeah.
Most of your gunfights take place between CD and B. I think there's a lack of vehicles, but if they did that to gain performance, I'm okay with it.
Yeah.
I mean, if that makes sense. Like, I would much rather have a game that plays well.
I think for me, the maps feel, at least size-wise, what was it in Battlefield 3? Armored Shield? That DLC, yeah. Which a lot of really big maps, and you had to rely on vehicles, and it seems like we've got a lot of really big maps now that you just don't have the vehicles, and so you have sporadic battles taking at place to place, and really no way to connect between the two other than dying and respawning somewhere else.
And we're running out in the open and getting tagged by snipers.
Yeah,
exactly. I'm pretty much the same boat.
Yeah, the one map we haven't talked about was Argonne, the forest map.
Yeah, I love that.
You mean indoor part two?
Yeah.
I'm pretty much in the same boat, Go. I mean, I would say, if I was going to list my top three, it would be probably, yeah, I'm in with St. Quentin is 2 and Ballroom 3, and then I like Argonne 2. That's a good one.
Yeah,
All right. Kickstand, what are your favorites?
He just rattled them off almost in the same order I would list them. And like I said, it's because, except for the forest map, that's almost all, it's almost like outdoor locker. I mean,
you've
got a couple enclosed, you know what I mean? But it's, you have like two or three flanking routes and there's a lot of action down there. Once again,
airburst mortars, right place at the right time. You just kill person after person. It's beautiful. Bo, what's your favorite?
Ballroom Blitz is my favorite.
That's a good one.
I like Ballroom Blitz because you can play multiple styles on that map and be effective. It's just, to me, it's well balanced. You've got close quarters play, you've got good medium range play, and if you like the long range stuff, you've got that in play too.
Absolutely.
I think that's probably the most well balanced map as far as all classes, all vehicles.
All right, and I think for me, like I said, Amiens is definitely my favorite. It reminds me of Sen, which I absolutely love that map. Just a really great map for both Rush and for regular Conquest. And then Ballroom's up there too. It's just a gorgeous map, you know, the palace and everything else. So moving on from maps, let's talk about game modes. So let's go with some of the favorite game modes here, what's working right now and what maybe isn't working. And I can tell you right off the bat, for me, my favorite game mode right now is War Pigeons. Absolutely love that game mode. I think it was a very, I don't want to say simplistic game mode, but it's ingenious in its simplicity. It's just a hell of a lot of fun, especially when you're playing with people, you know. Bo, let's start with you. What do you think about the game modes? What works for you right now, and what do you absolutely not like?
I like the large mode Conquest, but here lately I find myself playing more Dom. Domination to me in this game, it works really, really well. I haven't played War Pigeons.
Missing out.
Operations has the potential to be really good, but right now it's just not very good.
I think that's a console versus PC difference.
That's a sacrilege statement, right there.
Yeah, I mean, my problem right now with Operations is every time I play it, I'm on a map with a Zeppelin, and you might as well just hang it up if you're a defender.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's something that needs to be done there to balance that out.
I agree. I played with Paul last week, and, you know, you're defending, and you get a train, and then the enemy gets a train. But wait, there's more. They get another train.
I mean, you pretty much just get a train run on you on Operations on the defensive side. I love the thought behind Operations. But I kind of feel about it the same way I do about Rush. I mean, if you're the attackers on Rush, right now, you're pretty much going to run through things. If you're on defense on either one of those game modes, it's a pretty rough time. Although Rush is not quite as bad as Operations, it's That to me, those two game modes show off imbalances instantaneously in any kind of weapon or functionality in the game.
Absolutely. Kickstand, what are your favorites right now? What do you love more than any other mode?
Conquest is always going to be like, Conquest is my wife.
Well, that's Battlefield.
I know.
When you think of Conquest, you think of Battlefield and vice versa. I mean, the two are synonymous with each other.
That's always going to be my go-to, but I actually really like Operations. I think I really have a hard time with the concept of rewarding people for sucking, which is what the whole basis for the behemoths and the destroyer and all that other stuff are. But as a team, if you focus on those things, you can still roll the other team pretty easy. So I think if you're with a good squad or a good team, that when the behemoths and the dreadnought come in and you focus on them and you destroy them, Sure, you might lose a couple points, but you can roll the team after that. I think it has a lot of potential. I do think it needs some balancing tweaks for the defenders, but I think it has a lot of potential. War Pigeons is pretty damn fun too, but that's a game that really relies on you having good teammates. If you have a horrible team that's not PTFOing, or they're just sniping and kind of just drooling on themselves and not playing the objective, it can be horrible. But I think that game mode has a lot of potential. I'm bummed about Rush. I really don't like Rush.
I was waiting for someone to bring up Rush because no one had yet. And
really bummed. I don't know how the player count's too low for me. You have these waves of intense action, and then it dies down, and then you have these waves, and then it dies down. Whereas Rush in like Battlefield 3 and Battlefield 4, the attacking was constant. You had to be on your A game. Every death was important. Every ticket was important. And I just don't get that in Battlefield 1.
It's funny because going back to maps again, and I think part of the issue with Rush has been the movement away from what we had in Battlefield 3, which was more linear maps that forced you to go in almost a horizontal or a vertical movement, whereas now the maps are just huge. I mean, you can get, and it started in Battlefield 4. I mean, you saw it in maps like the railway map. What's the name of it? I can't even think of the names anymore.
Golmud.
Golmud, where you can attack from every direction.
And Sniper's Paradise.
Honestly, when I think of Rush, you know, I look back to Battlefield 3 and the maps there, and I know people bitch and moan about Metro and hating Metro, but as far as
Metro was a great Rush map.
It was.
Metro and Damavan Peak were the perfect Rush maps, and even Saint was a good Rush map. But I think Battlefield has moved away with that, where you've got multiple avenues, and you there's no focused battles. It's all coming from every direction, and for Rush, I just don't think that works. Rush is always about frantic battles where you're reviving the guy next to you, which doesn't happen nearly enough in this game. But it's forcing teamwork. It's forcing revives. It's crazy because explosions are going everywhere, but you're getting revived. And yeah, Rush is, it's a far cry from what it used to be in Battlefield 3.
Yeah, I agree with you a lot. I think when you think Conquest and Rush, Conquest to me is map control. Rush to me is lane control.
Exactly.
That's one of the only modes in Battlefield where I'm fine with having two or three lanes, like a Call of Duty map.
Exactly.
Because you have a lower player count, you have two objectives, you need to worry about your tickets and cover your lanes. That's it.
Exactly. Yeah.
And when you have these wide open maps where people are attacking, especially with the fast player movement, you have a ridiculous amount of flanking routes. You can't focus on, I'm a defender, I'm defending the objectives. You're defending 360 degrees. It's like Conquest with two. It's like a really mini Operations. It kind of killed it for me.
And again, that was the fun in Rush on maps like Metro. You know, you've got your LMG gunners just laying down prone, giving that supporting fire, and not even firing at anyone. They're just laying down
suppressive fire.
Then you've got people popping off with the noob tubes. It was smokes. A blast. Rush was probably my favorite game mode in Battlefield 3, and it's just unfortunate that it's devolved into what it is now, and it just started with Battlefield 4, and I don't think they recovered off of it. They took the Battlefield 4 method of it, which doesn't work. Paul, what do you think? What are your favorite modes right now, and do you agree with Rush being, well, Rush?
let's put it this way. I played the crap out of Rush during the beta, and I enjoyed it on the Sinai map.
Yep.
I saw a big issue with it, though, in that the defenders all played snipers. And that's what we have now. And it's ruined the game mode for Battlefield 1, I think, because the snipers are just so good, and everybody knows it. So all the defenders, you know, they can take long-range shots and pin these guys, and the attackers are afraid to approach the objectives. So, yeah, I mean, in terms of my least favorite mode right now, or I would probably say Rush is probably it, although I think that I'm not necessarily against the player count. I for one, be honest with you, I like the way it is. I wouldn't mind if it was 16v16, but 12v12 doesn't bother me because the actual area that you're fighting in really isn't all that big. But the snipers have ruined it, I think, on the PC for right now. Now, my favorite game mode, it's probably a toss-up between Operations and War Pigeons. I'll play either one all night. It doesn't matter. There is a lot of frustration with Operations, though, and like what Kick said, the behemoths are just high. They're just very frustrating when you're on the defense and you hold these guys, and now they get this big blimp or this big train to just release hell and you know, damnation on top of you for the next 30 minutes. It just becomes very frustrating. But the game mode, the way it's designed, the core design of it is fantastic. Now, Zoop, you'd be able to relate to this, but Lazy for Life, one of the Walking Dead Army guys, was saying when the first time he played it, he's like, this is kind of actually how war is. You know, you have a line that you attack. You have these objectives that you attack. You get them, you hold them, you move on to the next set. You know, and it just continues and continues and continues. And he said that's kind of how war, or battles, I should say, battles really progress. And he said he could see how Operations really could be great when you could build a good team. You have squads that are working together in PTFO, and so I think.
Yeah, but if you're stuck with a potato in the very beginning, it's just going to be half an hour to 45 minutes of pure torture.
Yeah.
Let's just go ahead right now and acknowledge the pleb randoms that take the train and drive it into the middle of the map and park it and never move it.
It's on rails. It's got a locomotive. Move it.
I can never get driver in it.
Yeah, there's wheels for a reason, people.
All back. it's those people. You should be able to auto kick those people.
Yeah. And it's so hard to get in one of those behemoths because people are just sitting and waiting for them when they know that they're going to come. I flown the blimp once and I did a pretty good job with that. Survivability was great. I drove the train once in beta and that was a blast because you can just go from cap to cap and just, you know, the support you can give if you play it right. But like you said, if you just go to the middle and sit in the center and allow yourself to get hit by airburst mortars.
Let me ask this. How good did it feel to be dropping debris on people again in this game?
Oh, it felt great.
Yes.
Campers, I love began. It.
Exactly.
Yeah, buildings are not safe anymore. It's awesome.
No, I love that. Absolutely love it. So let's talk about the individual classes now. This should be a pretty good conversation. And, you know, I had put weapons separate from that, but we'll roll weapons in with that because, you know, they're invariably going to come up. So let's start with medic right now, which many feel is the most underutilized class, or at least the least used correctly. And Pun, I see you shaking your head already, so why don't you start this off?
I think medic's probably the best, next to sniper's the best kit in the game. They definitely have the best all-around guns in the game, in my opinion. The sniper's guns are very powerful, usually a 1-2 shot kill. But, the medic guns are really good for close to medium range. They are, they're in the mid to upper 30s in damage in close range, so you're a 3-shot kill. You can get rounds off really quick. Most of them load fairly quick. If you prefer the medium range game, you have the optics that you could put, optic versions of the weapons for the most part that you could use, and I don't know. I love it. I can dominate with the guns. I have a good time with the minute guns. I don't have a problem with it. I know there's Not to call any names out, but Sergeant Danger Cow was complaining about the accuracy of them. I disagree with them. I think they're highly accurate. Matter of fact, on average, they're my most accurate guns in the game. I'm averaging about 40% with them. Well,
there's a caveat to that. You can't spam them. The spread on them is ridiculous. Even if your iron or your sight is on the target, if you're spamming, you're gonna miss. You have to wait a couple seconds for that tap.
Yeah. You learn a rhythm though. You pick the rhythm up on them. You get used to it, and I mean, it's not like you have to really wait a long time. I mean, this is that quick. You can get it, well, and the guys are down.
It's interesting you bring up that spread, because I've kind of learned with the trench gun that it's a lot better if you actually stop and fire it from a stopped position than if you're running. And it seems like it's just a hell of a lot more accurate that way, almost to the point that if you stop and fire, it's almost a guaranteed hit. Bo, what do you think about the medic class right now?
I think it's laughable that anyone thinks there's anything wrong with that class.
I agree with you. Go ahead, continue.
The two properly balanced classes in the game are the medic and the recon. I don't necessarily have a problem with the recon. The problem with the recons is more map design than it is class design.
Yeah, exactly.
I think the medic class to me is, I have no complaints with it. Mm-hmm. I get killed quite often by the medic class.
Yep.
And I don't see it as this widespread problem that people are making it out to be. Now, if you want to talk a different class, I mean, I got plenty to say about two of the other classes.
Oh, we'll get there. We're going there.
Yeah.
Trust me. I think, from my point of view, I think the medic class has really good weapons. I like the weapons. They're a lot of fun. My aim's not necessarily good enough to use them effectively right now, but that's on me, not on the weapons itself. The only issue I have, which isn't the class itself, and it's just the people playing the class. And you know, you've seen the memes now where, you know, you've got medics within 3, 4, 2 yards and then they start disappearing. I don't know what it is with this game, and maybe it's just a lot of new players are playing that have never played the Battlefield series before, but revives are few and far in between at this point, which is very, very disappointing. Now, I know it can't be that hard to use the syringe. It's not an issue of pressing 3 or 4 and then hitting it. People just aren't doing it. So maybe I don't think adding an incentive would help.
I'll tell you that syringe has the same problems that all the rest of the meta classes have had in every Battlefield game so far. There's several times I walk up on somebody with a syringe and hit them with it, and they don't revive.
Yeah, exactly. And that's happened to me a lot too, especially when I was trying to get that silly medal, which that's another issue, the medals. You know what? I didn't even write that down. Let's touch on that real quick before moving on to the other classes, because that is my biggest gripe with the game right now. I miss the ribbons. I absolutely miss ribbons. I wish they would have included them. This is kind of, I guess, more of Battlefield's influence, Battlefront's influence with the lack of ribbons and stuff. And I absolutely hate choosing medals. The medal should be something that happened naturally through just normal play of the game, coming from your accumulation of ribbons. And that's all I got to say about that.
I agree. I'm not necessarily big on the ribbons, but I don't like having to pick a medal and track it.
Ribbon in the game. And it's gone.
Yeah, when you meet an objective of a medal, it should give it to you regardless of whether you're tracking it or not. I don't know why they decided to do that. It makes no sense to me.
I really hope if they fix anything, they fix that, because honestly, it is an absolute pain in the ass.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I don't. And I'm not one. I'm terrible about going and picking a medal to track. I just don't think about it. I want to play the freaking game, you know.
Well, there's no. What do you get other than XP? Like, give me a reason to flounder through these menus and pick a medal. Like, I don't care about 10,000 or 20,000 XP if it takes me 10 minutes to figure out what friggin' medal I want to. Because you can select from 5. 4 of them are probably for a class or for challenges I just don't want to do.
And part of the other issue with it is, it alters your gameplay, and no metal should do that. No metal should force you to struggle to do something and tank your absolute. Honestly, when I noticed when I was trying for certain metals, I was playing in a way that I normally wouldn't play. I wasn't helping my team doing it. It just promotes bad gameplay.
Well, and honestly, that may have been the reason for pulling them out the way they did. You know, there were a lot of people talking about how do you change the PTFO mentality, and I mean, maybe that was the way they did it. I personally have never chased the medals or ribbons. I mean, if they happened organically in the game, super.
Yeah. That's how it was in games past. Battlefield 3 and Battlefield 4, they just happened naturally. It wasn't like I was going to go out and say, hey, I want to get my anti-air medal.
Some of them did. Some of them promoted them getting up on top of the highest building and seeing how many headshots they could get with a certain sniper rifle. I mean, I don't know. I mean, of all the things in the game that rubbed me the wrong way, that's way down the list. I mean, and not because I'm diminishing what you're saying. I'm just saying, like, the core gameplay is good. I tend to not pay too much attention to stuff like
that. Well, I think from my point of view, it's probably a good thing that this is one of my biggest gripes, because it just goes to further show how well everything else is running.
That's how spoiled we are right now.
Yeah, exactly. You know, we're picking on ribbons and medals. So, all right, let's move on to the recon class. This should be interesting. Bo, let's start with you on this.
I mean, the best thing I could, about the best thing I could say about the recon class is, you know, I don't know if you guys saw Jack Frag's video on the sniper rifles when he was talking about the damage models per rifle.
Honestly, I haven't watched it. Sorry,
Jack. It was a pretty straight up video on the sniper class, and I can't say that I disagree with it. When I talk about the sniper class, I think it's very well balanced, and then I look at again, other classes, and I'm like, we need to have a conversation about those. So, I don't have any issues with the recon class.
Kickstand, what about you?
I'm actually fine with the scout class. I think they've dialed in a lot of the guns. I like the whole sweet spot mechanic where different guns have different perfect ranges to get one or two shot kills, especially to the body. I don't really have a problem with the class. It's some of the people that use it. I think the class itself is balanced. It's the jabronis that are using it and lighting up the sky like a bunch of Riris. But I actually like the class. I'm not big on scout gameplay because I like to run and gun. I like to flank. I'm always on flags. But as a class compared to other Battlefield games, I think this is actually a pretty balanced scout class. I don't have any real complaints with it.
Pun.
It's the number one class in the game, I think, in terms of ease of use. I'm going to be honest with you. I think the scout guns are by far the easiest to get used to in terms of other... I'm comparing it to other games. The scout guns are just point-and-shoot, basically. I mean, there's no drop-off prior to 150 meters. They are going to be a one- to two-shot kill no matter where you hit them at. I love the damage profiles. I have no problems with damage profiles. I just think they need to be harder to use. Minimal scope sway.
Yeah.
Recoil. Yeah. There's hardly any recoil compared to what you used to see. You don't even use the hold the breath. You have that available, but you don't need to use it because you don't.
Wait,
so
wait, that's an option?
You don't use it. You don't need to. You have it, but you don't need it because there's hardly any scope sway. So I think some of those things.
Didn't even know it was available.
Now some of those things need to be tweaked a little bit to make them truly a strong bolt action rifle. I think for the PC, generally speaking, it's not necessarily a big deal unless, like I was saying, you're playing Rush. Rush, you see a lot of people playing Sniper. It's just that it's just really easy. And I'm saying this because it's my number one kit right now. I play it more than anything else, and that shouldn't be the case because I sucked at sniping in every other game.
Yeah, me too.
You just got good.
I was like, man.
I personally, I don't know that much needs to change there. I think when you talk the difference between PC and console, that's a little bit better conversation. Again, back to the separate weapon profiles.
Yeah.
Um,
yeah. Too easy.
But I'm okay with the sniper rifles being vicious. If you want to be vicious at long range, be vicious at long range. But if I want to be vicious up close, then you need to change that TTK to match those kits accordingly.
Yeah.
Well, like I said, and I don't have a problem with the damage on the sniper guns. I think they should be one shot to two shot kills, especially if you're doing headshots. If you're doing headshots, you're dead, man. That's the way it should be.
That's right.
But. Yeah. You know,
it should be harder to get headshots, though.
Exactly. I mean, you need that scope to move around a little more than what it's doing. You know,
50 meters. Within 100 meters, a headshot should be fairly easy. But you know, it's a lot more simple past that too. So let's talk about support class right now.
Oh yeah,
womp womp.
I mean,
why don't you kick that off? I see you nodding your head right there.
Yeah, fun. Oh, no, I can't stand the support.
You're not in your head, too. You're not.
Go ahead, Bun. He's more of an Ellen, a support player than I ever was. So.
Yeah, I can't stand the support. I really don't. I hate it. The guns are great. I understand what they were trying to do with the profiles. You look at the damage profiles, and from 0 meters out to 100 meters or whatever distance, there's maybe a 2 to 3 hit point difference in damage for the most part. They're very close. So over the range, they're very strong guns. But let's be totally honest. How many people using LMGs are going to engage a guy at 100 meters away? Mm-hmm. There's just not a lot. I mean, the average engagement range in Battlefield, and it's the same for Battlefield 1, is 30 to 40 meters. And that's where, that's where most people feel comfortable at engaging their targets. And inside of that. And inside of 20, 30, 40 meters, the LMGs are absolutely horrible. Because the damage is they're shooting freaking Nerf bullets. Some of them are not bad. Some of them are, I think, 24. Some of them are up around 27. There's a few. But a lot of them are basically five-shot kills. When you're going against a medic gun, that's a three-shot kill out to 30 meters. And you're going against SMGs that are typically six. Some of them are eight-shot kills, but they're some of them are pretty fast. They shoot really fast. Everything just outperforms the LMG in the engagement ranges that you typically see people doing. Now, great, yes, they are fantastic at long range. They do a great job at long range, and that's really what they're designed for. But I'm going to add this, and this is what I said in my thoughts video. Because the scouts are so good, if you prone yourself or you put yourself up in a bipod, which is what DICE intended with LMGs, you become a bullseye for the scouts. Mm-hmm. And it's just very hard to play their support right now because scouts are so good and the medic guns are so good at medium range that if you stop, you're good as dead.
I'm gonna talk about support because this is near and dear to my heart. Support is probably my most played class right now. I consider myself a support player above all. And I agree with you. The LMGs are tremendously weak. I will say the Hewitt is a pretty good gun. It's a lot of fun. I enjoy it a lot. I like that slow fire. It feels to have a lot more control.
And that's the only exception to the guns. That gun is actually pretty good. That gun that you can fall to that does give you a decent damage profile up close. But it is, like you said, it's extremely slow, but it's also extremely accurate.
Yeah, but honestly, when I play LMG, I honestly consider my LMG a secondary weapon. I really view myself as a mortarman when mm-hmm. I play as support. And the reason being is the airburst mortar is so effective against enemy encampments. It's so good against, prone players that I find that on larger maps or especially playing War Pigeons, it's extremely effective in taking out the enemy that I really only use LMG if I get in a close quarters fight, which, again, it's like 50-50 at that point because you're going to get outgunned by just about everything else. But my job as support is throwing down weapons crates And when we're hunkered down, just putting that mortar plate down and just blasting the enemy from there, to the point that I probably have more kills with the mortars than I do with the LMG guns. Now, I know some people hated that type of gameplay in Battlefield 4. People hated mortars. But I really think that for the support play, and as one of those players, I hated that in Battlefield 4. I loved the LMGs. The Pechenegg was my favorite. But I rarely use mortars. But in this game, I find myself using it almost exclusively just because it's so effective and because the LMGs are so ineffective. And I would really like to see them buff the damage maybe a little bit or something. There's just something completely lacking with a gun that should strike fear.
It may be a spread issue. It may just be that the spread needs to be tweaked.
That's another part of it.
It's a spread issue because you can be up front. Well, and it's not just spread, though, because I've been in the lower level guns. You can be within 10 yards of someone, and it feels like I'm putting 6 or 7 shots into them, and they're still beating me. I know the shots are hitting, but they'll walk away with 33 damage, and they'll have their medic weapon or whatever else, and you wind up dead, and there's nothing you can do about it.
Mm-hmm.
So,
as much as I hate the spread of the LMGs, and I complained about them and the SMGs, I'm going to put this out there. This is by far the most accurate in terms of stats that I've had in any Battlefield game.
Yeah.
I have never achieved an average accuracy of 24-25% across the board. I just really haven't. And even the LMGs, I'm, you know, over 20%, which is really, you know, astonishing for me, to be honest with you. I know some people,
you know,
they're just
close.
That good, but
up close with the LMGs, you're almost better off hip firing. I honestly think when you're within 10-15 yards of the enemy, you have better accuracy hip firing than you do aiming down sights.
You have better accuracy with your pistol, which is beast.
Your pistol is awesome. Yeah, you should be using your pistol in close quarter battles. The pistol is
pistols
awesome
are strong.
Absolutely. I'm glad pistols are relevant, to be honest with you. I'm glad they play use. I barely the only time I ever used them in BF4 is when I dumped a clip and I was in a holy shit moment.
Yep.
To fire off a couple rounds to finish the kill and reload your primary.
Yeah.
No, I love pistols.
The thing with LMGs, real quick, with the spread, is you have to remember, you have to get out of the mindset of playing what we used to play in Battlefield 4, Battlefield 3, and that you do not burst fire those LMGs. You have to hold them down to gain accuracy. You know, that second shot penalty is brutal, but after about the fourth shot, the accuracy really pulls back in really good, and you can do well. And they were intending to do that to make it a longer range suppressive weapon.
Yeah, you can't do that up close because that second, if you miss that second shot, you're dead.
Yeah, that's the problem with up close.
Yep.
Please let me start the assault. Please let me start the assault.
Go ahead, Bo. Start the assault.
All right. Very first thing, biggest problem with the assault class, number one, the throw radius on the TNT needs to be upped. The throw radius on the TNT is too short. You're just about throwing it on top of yourself every time you throw it. That's complaint number one. Complaint number two is that the shotguns are too inconsistent. I've got recorded several times where I'm scratching someone's back with the shotgun and pull the trigger and they're not folding over. It's 1, 2, 3 hits. I think that there's a lot of inconsistencies with the shotgun. I know a lot of people get mad when they get broken in half by one in close quarters combat. These people don't understand the way shotguns should work. I shouldn't be able to hit you at 50 meters, but I should be able to completely tear you apart inside of 20 meters.
Yep.
I
find that to be a problem too, because when I play assault, I almost exclusively play shotgun. I use assault when I know I'm going to be in close quarters battles. And too many times I'll have someone 5 feet in front of me and I don't get exactly on them. I might be to the side, but I'm doing no damage at all. And that shouldn't be the case with a shotgun. You should be getting damage regardless that close. I mean,
yeah, the time to kill on the SMGs in close quarters is absurd. I mean, you spend a lot of time counting hit markers. You know, you just about have to mag dump with an SMG in close quarters to get a kill. this goes back to my whole argument that I'm fine if you want to make the snipers a beast, but please make the other kits functional in their role. And I don't feel like support and assault are there yet. Like, they're just not polished yet in their role.
No, they're the redheaded stepsisters of the game right now.
Yeah.
But
I mean, you guys know, like, in the Hangout chat, I mean, the first couple of days, I was about ready to just snap things in half over how inconsistent the shotguns were.
Yep. No, I agree, and that's one of the issues that I kind of moved away from it. I mean, I love shotgun play, but, you know, it's just not fun where one second you'll hit someone and kill them, and the second, you know, person you'll aim in the exact same place, and it's like you don't even hit them. There's no consistency whatsoever. Pun, before we come to you, do we want to do a giveaway real quick? I know we've got two games and people are probably eager. Do we want to start the roll on maybe Battlefield?
I'm asking around, see what they want. I've got Battlefield 1, TF2. I tell you what, let's go ahead and we'll do Battlefield 1 first. Because I've only got one of those giveaway. I've got a. If I want to, I can give away a metric butt ton of Titanfalls. But so what we'll do is we'll go ahead and start the raffle. So guys, what you're going to do is you're going to, when I start the raffle, I don't remember exactly what the code is. I think it's exclamation point raffle. Enter your name in the raffle if you want Battlefield 1. I would ask that if you already have Battlefield 1 and Premium, don't put your name in. Be fair to the people that don't have the game and want to get the game.
This is for PC too, right, Paul?
And it is for PC. This only works for PC. So if you have a PC, you don't have Battlefield 1, you want it, put your name in the raffle. But here's the caveat. You have to be following. If I go and we pull your name and I go and look and you're not in the following list, we're going to pull another name. So I'll go ahead and start Z raffle now.
All right, so Kickstand, what do you think?
Yeah, so it's hashtag raffle. There it goes.
Yeah, as far as assault goes,
I have the same general complaint with the TNT. I have another complaint with the AT gun. When you're trying to deploy that on like a windowsill or a ledge or a rock, or even when you're dropping down, going prone and deploying it, it can be really clunky and slow sometimes.
Yep, I agree too.
So it's super inconsistent on when and where it's going to deploy. TNT throw distance, I would like to see increase, but not like Battlefield 4 where you're throwing ham sandwiches across the map, you know, increased. It's always been my go-to class because especially in this Battlefield, because they're catering to the casual audience. I don't like seeing a tank and knowing I have to depend on the blueberries to take that tank down.
Yeah.
I like saying, you know what, I'm going to take this tank down because with two anti-tank grenades and a couple shots in the ass, I can take that down.
Yep, exactly.
I actually really like the weapons. As far as like the weapons go, I think they did a good job balancing it. I was totally against the way they were balancing it when I first started playing in the alpha and the beta, but now that I've seen how it is in practice, I think we were really spoiled in BF4 with the carbine class because that was the gun that could do anything you wanted depending on the loadout and everything.
Yeah.
I like the assault class.
Love the
yeah, MTAR. Exactly. MTAR, the ACW.
MTAR was my favorite.
G36. I mean, that wasn't statistically the greatest, but I mean,
yeah,
you could have a carbine for any class that would do anything you wanted. And I'm really liking the niche roles that these classes are filling in Battlefield 1. It actually, it's nice.
I will say, My biggest thing is regarding at least shotguns. I really wish they would open shotguns up to the medic class as well. I would love to see them have that.
I actually agree with that because that pushes medics up on the front line with you guys, especially in the close quarter maps. They're not hanging back.
Really need it if you're a medic that actually plays the way a medic should, and you're reviving your players. You're going to be the one that needs that shotgun more than anyone else. So I would love down the road for them to maybe consider giving the trench gun to the medic.
I mean, you can do it with the pilot. With the pilot and tank class, instead of using the carbine, you can use a shotgun, so why not do that for the medics?
I wouldn't mind seeing it as an all kit.
I don't want to see a lot of cross-mixing of weapons in classes, because I think that's where they went wrong in Battlefield 4.
Okay, so you don't think medics should have shotgun then?
No, I mean, I don't necessarily think that they should not have shotgun, but, you know, it's that whole where do you stop?
Yeah.
I don't want to see DMRs in every class. I don't want to see, you know, I don't want to see all that. It's where do you stop at? Do you only want to talk close quarters guns? I'm okay with that.
Yeah, that I would love that's exactly where I would stop.
I would love for shotguns to be across all classes.
Because or at least every class.
Or at least a shotgun. You know, not maybe not all of them, but at least a shotgun that everybody can choose.
Yeah, I doubt any recon player is going to choose a shotgun.
Oh, please do. Please do.
Exactly.
Please do.
But
come,
I mean,
come play with the real men out on the objective. Come play.
They would work well with support. They would work well with medics. And, if you know, they would work well with us with, you know, that. I mean, this. Yeah, you're right. The scout wouldn't be a good pick. But, I mean, every other one, you could see that there's a function of the shotgun that would work for their style. Because I want my support guy, you know, kind of on the front lines too, giving me ammo because, you know, frankly, I shoot and miss a lot and I run out of bullets. So,
yep. All right, so wrapping up the classes then, Paul, what's your favorite gun right now?
Oh, man, it's very class specific. I don't have one favorite gun, and I guess that's the great thing about the game right now. There's not a standout gun for me. Class specific, assault is the Heikendall? I can't remember the name of it. The Hellriegel. There you go. Thank you. Yeah. The 1915 is an awesome assault gun. My go-to for medic right now is the Rigotti Optic. I love that one a lot. Scout, I play around with all of them. It just really depends on how I'm feeling. The Martini's a fantastic gun, though. I'm not going to deny it. That Martini destroys
Martini,
people.
Kickstand, what are your favorites?
For assault, I don't know why more people aren't using this gun, but the Automatico Trench is a hipfire AEK. Like I barely ever ADS with that gun because if you're in that gun's effective range, I'm gonna hipfire your head off. You're not gonna win a gunfight against me. Hellriegel is my go-to for maps that have longer lines of sight. It's really good on ballroom blitz.
It is
so many
ballroom.
People at that C objective.
Yep. Fantastic gun on it.
Hold on, I've got it up right now. But what I started doing is I wanted to get level 10 with assault, level 10 with medic, just so I could get all the higher unlock guns.
Right.
I really like the Selbst. What is that? The Selbst Slatter 1916 for the medic class. I really like that. The SMLE for the scout, and then the Bar Storm is my go-to for the for the support. That's a really good gun.
Bo, how about you?
I like the Rigotti Optical for the medic, the SMLE for the recon class.
That's a good one.
Yeah. It's I'm not even going to talk about the support class because it's just not mentionable to me.
RIP.
And the Model A10 Hunter shoddy on the assault class, just put me around the objective with that and make me happy all day.
All right. For me, I love the trench gun, just the standard trench gun. Enjoy that a lot. The SMLE is also a lot of fun. I gravitate towards that when I play recon. And since I play support the most, I did love the bar until I unlocked the Hewitt. And as of right now, the Hewitt is definitely my favorite. Hewitt's just a great gun. As far as handguns go, I don't think I've unlocked anything other than the 1911 because I absolutely love the 1911. And for me, that's all
I was going to say.
That's
it's 1911 because America.
Yeah, exactly. I don't need another handgun. So, did we have a winner from that raffle?
Yeah, the real Lurchy 39 won.
Lurchy won it. Lurchy, congratulations, Lurchy. That's awesome.
Yeah, all man. Right, and he does follow, so that's it.
Let's cover something else real quick before we do the Titanfall 2 drawing. This is going to be a pretty good discussion right here.
Oh, here we go.
Gas. and I'll start this off. Honestly, from my perspective, I have no issues with the way gas is employed. I don't have any issues with gas whatsoever at this point. I think it's synonymous with World War I. You have to deal with it as they did. You've got gas masks for a reason. If you can't be bothered to press T, you deserve to die. You put the mask on. If you're in a situation where there's gas, you hit fire. I think that's a cool mechanic. Personally, I think gas works as intended. I think it adds a dynamic to the battlefield. I see no issues with it. Who wants to debate that?
I am not as heavy on it as you are.
Right. Go ahead, Pond. Go ahead.
I don't mind the effectiveness of the gas. And in most maps, the gas is not an issue. I have no problems with it in Conquest. I really don't have much of a problem with it in Operations. I do have a problem with it in War Pigeons. War Pigeons, it is absolutely freaking ridiculous. And the other mode, Domination, I play a lot of Domination too. You see it a lot in Domination, to where you are virtually running around the whole map trying to hip fire because you have to wear your gas mask. And I just, from a pure gunplay standpoint, I just don't like it. And I don't think it's because they're over the effectiveness is overpowered. I just think that it's too readily available for everybody to use. I think that it needs to be limited in your kits on what you how you can use it. I mean, it seems, and it, everybody uses it, and it just, oh my god, in War Pigeons, it's terrible. Absolutely freaking terrible. I can't stand it. It drives me nuts.
I think that adds to the joy of War Pigeons, though. War Pigeons is just absolutely insane. Kickstand, what do you think about gas?
I actually don't mind it as a game mechanic, but I only play the larger game modes. War Pigeons, everything's focused on that one objective, so it's everyone's going to spam gas on it. I think if you're the easiest way to quell some of the qualms, that's a lot of cues that some people have with the gas nades, is either give people one nade instead of two, or make them replenish longer, just so they're not being spammed as much. But I actually don't mind them. You throw one T, but that comes from an assault player too, who uses weapons that are catered to hipfire. So
honestly, in War Pigeons, I don't see gas as an issue, because half the time the people that wind up with the pigeons do the foolish thing and try to run to the corners of the map. Which, when they do that, I just throw airburst in their direction, and that's the end of that. So again, I love airburst. Bo, what's your feeling about gas?
I have no problems with it. I do think that Pun brings up a good point, and there's some precedent here, right, for dealing with game modes. Mm-hmm. You know, coming from Hardline, the gas in Hardline's vicious. I mean, the gas in Hardline drives gameplay, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, in that regard, to me, it wasn't a big adjustment. I mean, I had been playing a game where that was a factor. But also in Hardline, like with Hotwire, when you had too many RPGs, it took the high-speed chase effect out of it. They removed a lot of that out of the Hardline game mode. So mm-hmm. if the issue in War Pigeons is that functionality is kind of messing that mode up, I mean, to me, there's some precedent in Battlefield games overall that, you know, they could remove some things from some of those game modes and clean that up. And to me, those are just polish issues to be patched later.
Yeah.
I don't think it really affects War Pigeons that much. There's instances, I think it only does when people try and hide under the particular buildings that they're in to try and write the message before launching. And that's where it gets pretty crazy. And, you know, everyone's in the same situation, though. It's not like one team is forced to wear their gas mask and the other one's free to fire how that is. When you launch gas, everyone's got to put their gas mask on, so everybody's still fighting at the same level. It's just an inconvenience.
I mean, as someone who's constantly pushing the objective, it's awesome when you have a medic who decides he wants to go camp a corner on an objective, mm-hmm. pop some gas in there and take away his ADS. Okay.
Yep.
I mean, it's a tactic. People, I mean, they're just going to have to learn to adjust to it, in my opinion.
That's what I feel, too. Do we want to go ahead and we're kind of running down topics or kind of coming to a cease. We've got a few more left. You want to go ahead and start the raffle for Titanfall 2?
Yeah, we'll go ahead and do that. Hold on a second. I'm trying to message Lurchy and try to get him to code here. Let's see. Let me reset the raffle. We'll do it.
Yeah, we'll get it to you, Lurchy. Don't worry about it.
Maybe.
It's coming. So, yeah, I'm just trying to message you right now.
Has anyone else here played it besides you, Pun?
Titanfall 2.
I haven't had a chance to play it yet.
I've only played a very small portion of the campaign. I don't have, and I'll be honest, I don't know enough of it to really give you a solid.
Consensus is right now, I think it's another winner, so it's looking to be a very good month for EA. While that's running, let's move on real quick to vehicles, just kind of cover horses, tanks, planes, all that. Bo, let's start with you. What do you think about vehicle play right now? And I call a horse a vehicle, even though it's a mammal. But
I mean the horse plane. I know Adonis is in the chat potentially, but the horse play is epic.
Man, I like love the cavalry. I love the sword. I love the cavalry. I love the mechanics.
Yeah, the cavalry play is epic. It's a great addition to the game. I have some minor complaints with the tanks. You know, switching from one weapon to another, there is a definite and noticeable lag that, in my opinion, shouldn't be there. Like, I know they don't want you to spam the guns back and forth, but it's almost like it's tweaked too far one way.
BF3.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's something in my throat.
Thirsty gunner.
I think the bombers are spectacular. If you have someone who can run the bombers and
repair and fly, yeah.
Repair, fly, and just pace the objectives. When you're trying to push an objective, if they're paying attention to where the fight's happening, if they can bomb and support, I mean, it's, to me, that's an awesome dynamic.
Well, not only that, that front gunner seat on the bomber, I'll usually take that if I get in a bomber. I try to avoid flying because those flights don't last that long right now, but that gun on the front seat of the bomber can be absolutely brutal up close. I mean, the bomber is just an absolutely great plane. And the other planes are too. They're a lot of fun. I've gotten one of the two-seaters with a pilot that's probably the best pilot I've wound up in the game with. I mean, he was doing, you know, barrel rolls and all kinds of insanity that I couldn't even dream of mastering. But I think the air battles, I think they're pretty well balanced, and I see no big issues with that. I don't see the planes as overly strong to the point that they're unfair on the ground. I know some people might have different feelings about the tanks, though. Does anyone want to comment on the tanks and their lethality? Yeah. Or
I love the tanks.
Yeah, I mean, they're powered well.
Okay.
To me, my only complaint with them is it just feels too, I don't want to say laggy, but it takes too much time to switch from one gun to the other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It'd be functional.
I think, like we mentioned earlier, I might like to see maybe two tanks on some maps per team, as opposed to just one where the player gets to select the tank type, and you're stuck with that. Because, but let's face it, sometimes you're in a battle that requires a certain type of tank, and you get a blueberry in there that picks a tank that you really don't need or want at that point in time, and it just sets you behind. So maybe the ability to have more than two would be nice. I don't know. But overall,
you also have the problem with, and this is a player problem, not a game problem, but we all know those special individuals who grab a tank, and instead of providing support firepower, they drive right onto the flag, and then the tank just is annihilated.
Yeah,
it gets blown up right on. Those are special individuals.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, like you said, that's not a gameplay issue. I think the vehicle gameplay is balanced. I don't see any of the vehicles as overly strong or overly weak. I think maybe I would just like it to be more Battlefield, with maybe just a little bit more vehicle focus and on some of the maps. Some of the maps that can afford it, you know, the bigger maps where you got to go across five clicks of sand to get to that that one capture point, you know, maybe having more than just one tank would be nice on those maps. I know they got the nice little the four wheelers and everything, but that's my only thing. But other than that, I think they did a good job. Hun, do you think so?
Overall, yeah. I mean, as far as the tanks go, I think the tanks are great. I think the nerf that they did to the light tank with the canister shell is perfect. I like where the range is now with that. I still love the default kit with the light tank. I still love playing it because, in my opinion, it's the most effective in terms of overall use. I think the ability to give health and ammo out with that is just fantastic. Plane-wise, I hate the attack planes now. Only attack plane that I think is worthwhile using is the ground support. I think the tank hunter plane, they nerfed the crap out of the gun. Yeah, and I understand why. I know why, but they nerfed it too much, I think, because now you don't stand a chance if you get in a dogfight with anybody. If you try to go against a bomber, I mean, you're talking, it's taken me 3-4 shots with that gun to take a bomber out, and the guns, the secondary guns on the bombers and other attack planes are so good that they will take you out long before you'll ever take them out. And the buff to the tail gunners are brutal. But I mean, I understand it. I just I don't know. It's like they buffed the tail gunners and the front gunners on the bomber to counteract the tank hunter primary gun. But then they's like, oh, we're going to nerf that too. So then it just totally put everything back out of balance again. So anyway, overall, I don't have any problems with any of the vehicles other
Pun,
than
you're,
function.
You're now German now. Your name is Pun the Hun.
Pun the Hun.
All right, so we've got one more topic before we go into our overall final thoughts and everything. And I think this one is definitely a contentious topic also, and that's behemoths. And personally, I'm not a huge fan of them. I think they're really cool, and it's awesome watching a giant dirigible blow up. But I don't like how they're employed. And I think in the majority of times that I've been on a team that has them or going against them, it completely alters the side of the battlefield. And I know, Kick, you mentioned earlier that it's almost like rewarding poor play. Mm-hmm. And I really think it sets a bad precedence. You know, maps like Amiens, where the train rolls right down the middle, I mean, it's almost unstoppable for a time. Yeah. So
that divides the whole map in half if it's played well. You can dominate a whole half of the map. I don't – if they're going to have them in the game, don't have them be as strong. I don't mind helping really, really bad teams. Maybe increase the score gap to where they're triggered. So
maybe
it's
about
not like
200 or 250.
Yeah, not like 150 or 100.
Where it might help them a little bit, but
exactly. It should be more of a nuisance than, oh, my God, here comes a behemoth. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yep.
That's my only problem with them.
All right.
Granith won Titanfall.
Oh, who won? Ed won? Oh, nice.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
GG, Ed.
Well, what do you think about behemoths?
I mean, it's pretty much the same thing you guys are saying. Yeah.
Aside from the dreadnought I find to be absolutely useless and really just kind of a waste of space. That one needs tweaking if they wanted to work like the other ones. Or maybe it works the way the other one should. You know, it's just kind of there, and you got people going after it with the torpedo boats, which is kind of fun, but I haven't seen the dreadnought turn the tide of any battles. Not the way that the train or the
it doesn't have the range to the objectives to the interior of the map.
Yeah, exactly.
To get it done,
affect the whole map like you can with the
yeah.
Airship.
That's kind of like on Sinai, right? Like Sinai is such a big map that the train really, most of the times I'm playing, whoever's driving the train just wants to roll up to D and see how many kills they can get. I mean, you know, they're not really gonna grab all the other objectives, and even if they did, by the time they roll off, you're just going to grab the objective right back. So I don't know that they're anything more than just the KD booster, honestly.
That's kind of how I see it.
It's a way for a bad team to feel just a little bit better before they lose. That's all it is.
Yeah.
Well, but
socialist.
Yeah, but you know, for the rounds that are close though, that are within the, you know, the bare minimum, I'd say 75% of the games I've been in, it has created a win for the losing team, which I don't think that should be the case. I think if you played well, you know, the other team shouldn't get rewarded with something that hands them the victory in the last seconds. That's kind of unfair, forcing you to devote all your time to a giant blimp when you've been attacking each objective and playing the way you need to be. So, yeah, I think increasing the skill gap, you know, if you're down 200 or 250, you know, it might get you close to winning, but if you don't start coming together as a team, it's not going to get you there. Pun, what do you think? Do you kind of have the same views about them? Yeah. Or
I'm not a fan of them. I think that it's a way for the losing team to regain some of their stats that they got beat up by, and I don't know. I hate it, to be honest with you. I want it. I don't necessarily mind it so much in Conquest. I mean, I don't like it, but I can get it. I can deal with it in Conquest. But I think like in some of the other modes, man, I just don't think
that operations. It ruins it.
I don't like it. I think it just needs to go away. And I'm hoping that that's going to be a server option that you can do that without screwing your server up. You know, when that becomes available, if that ever comes available.
What servers are you talking about?
Yeah, exactly. That's something we haven't brought up, the servers with the lack of options, the ability to kick ban and everything else, which I would imagine at some point they're going to implement. I'm kind of upset that they didn't from the get-go, but it seems like they listened to our feedback on those, and they saw the outcry, so I would imagine that that's going to come in the near future. So,
well, you know, Zoop, we got to show talking in the chat to talk about the elite classes. We haven't talked about that.
No, we haven't.
And then, like behemoths, all right, if I have a distaste for behemoths, I downright hate elite classes, and I feel that they should not be in the game whatsoever. In War Pigeons, if you get a sentry or a freaking flamethrower, it can completely just devastate the enemy team. So that's one of the things that that's one of the things from Battlefront they brought over, and
just gonna say that. Thanks, Battlefront. Heroes. Hero pickups.
Thanks, yeah, the hashtag thanks Battlefront. they should not be in there. Those are my thoughts on it. Bo, what do you think?
I think it's mode dependent.
Absolutely.
I think that, you know, Conquest, they're not that bad. I mean, you can counter them in Conquest all day long.
I don't mind them in Conquest either.
Yeah, don't mind them really, honestly, in Operations if you didn't have to deal with the behemoths. But, you know, the smaller game modes, I can definitely see where, you know, that again, back to that whole precedent of, you know, Hardline pulling things back from certain game modes, that may be something that they want to reevaluate.
Yeah, get rid of them in War Pigeons. Especially like you said, Conquest. Yeah, Conquest, I can deal with them because I can be 5 capture points away from them and not have to worry about them. But War Pigeons, no.
Drives me freaking crazy in War Pigeons and Domination. They oh my god, it drives me crazy. The flamethrower coming on a flag in Domination.
Crazy. While we're talking about, you know, what we don't like about them, I do like it. It does seem like they've tweaked them a bit since the beta. They were ridiculous in the beta.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They don't seem quite as powerful as the beta, but they still pack a wallop.
I feel like everything that was wrong with the beta, they actually balanced quite well post-release, except for, like Pun was saying, the anti-tank plane.
Yeah, I was surprised about that, because usually when a beta comes out a month or two from game launch, you don't think they're going to switch much at all. But
they did a really good job. I think it's the most well-balanced, especially vehicle-wise, the most well-balanced Battlefield at launch, like without a day one patch or a day two, a week two patch. I would dare say, especially the light tanks, because I thought they were fine. I didn't like all the bitching and moaning, but I think that the little tweaks that they did actually did improve gameplay with them and against them. But I'm kind of impressed, because we saw how that went in Battlefield 4, where you had weeks where the pendulum would swing one way, then it would swing the other, then it would swing the other way. You had this real back and forth. I mean, the SRA, that thing was god mode for a few months, then they nerfed into Oblivion, then they brought it back. We haven't seen that so far, knock on wood, with Battlefield 1.
I don't really think they're going to need a whole bunch of balancing.
That's a testament of how balanced everything is right now.
I think they will for, you know, the assault and support classes. I think definitely they're going to need to learn how to tweak those to get them up to the same amount of usage the other ones are and the effectiveness. But aside from that, it's only 2 classes. I mean, it's not like it's half of them or anything. But
to me, the things that are going to prompt, you know, patches or balancing, you know, I'm okay if they want to tweak the balancing on assault or support. What I don't want to have happen is the knee-jerk reaction, like in Battlefield, where we're just going to do it overall to everything. And then, I mean, it just, it was a miserable experience, and I'm just really hoping they don't go that way. Because, I mean, you see it on social media daily, people complaining, you know, the sniper should have this, you should have that. Look, I'm okay. If the snipers are awesome at their role, leave them awesome at their role.
Absolutely.
But don't make them awesome at another kit's role for the sake of making it useful. And I think that's really what we're getting at with the LMGs is they're not even useful in the role that they're supposed to be playing right now.
And I think that comes back to as well as good game design should reward good players and it should make bad players better. You should never change bad good game design to help improve bad gameplay.
Very good point there.
I really hope they stick to their guns on that. They've done a good job so far, I think.
Mm-hmm. All right, so I think we've covered just about everything. We'll start with final thoughts. I'll give mine. I think it's a hell of a lot of fun. I'm extremely pleased with Battlefield 1 right now after the pile of steaming doggy poo that was Battlefield 4. You know, I see a lot of promise in Battlefield 1. I'm enjoying it a lot. For the first time in a while, I have an actual desire to come home and play it, and play it on the weekends, which has been lacking for a very, very long time. It's a lot of fun squatting up. Graphically and sound-wise, it's probably one of the best games I've ever played. Is it better than Battlefield 3 in its heyday? I can't honestly answer that yet because I put close to 1,000 hours in on Battlefield 3, which is probably less than some, but one of the most I put in our game. And really, the rush and everything in Battlefield 3 is, I think, what got me there. So I'll need to put a little more time in Battlefield 1 for me to determine if it's, in my opinion, better than Battlefield 3. But it's definitely up there, and I'm really enjoying it. And I have to commend EA and DICE for really righting the wrongs that had happened in the past with Battlefield 4 and giving us something on day one that, you know, is just really awesome. So, Bo, what do you think?
I mean, I think for a launch, it's been awesome. I think that coming from the catastrophe that was Battlefield 4, to how just wonderful it's been to play this at launch. It's all, I mean, I don't know what else to say. It's awesome. I mean, visually the game's stunning. The sound is on point as usual. I don't feel like I'm having some of the same issues that I had even towards the end of Battlefield 4. Or even in Battlefront. I mean, some of the time to kill issues in Battlefront, that was a more casual shooter. I think the people who say that this doesn't feel like Battlefront aren't giving credit to the fact that it's mostly engine related, right? Like, this game is every bit as pretty as Battlefront was, right?
Mm-hmm.
But
if not better.
If somebody asked me, would you spend money on this game right now? I would wholeheartedly say yes. But I'm also going to put this asterisk out there. We all know that as we get new content and as they patch the game, things tend to work really, really well, or things tend to work not really, really well.
Yeah. Let's Overwatch on that, because that game came out beautifully. This last patch broke a lot of things. God, oh man.
So, I mean, for me, I'm really loving the game. And more importantly, I really kind of feel like the things that we were being told by EA and by DICE and by the CMs publicly was closer to being factual and true than not true, right? And we couldn't say that before. Like I feel like the product has been turned around a bit and redeemed itself some.
Yep.
And it's a testament to those guys who pushed that. I know it was a lot of work. I want to give credit where credit's due. I mean, I think they've done a good job coming back from, you know, the things that the community really, you know, had a legitimate concern about.
Yeah, I agree. Paul, pun the hun.
Big hunter.
Yes. I think that I'll go ahead and say it. I think that is, if the servers work out favorably for us as a community, and that we get relatively decent controls of the servers, and that we can admin them and make our servers the way we like to play them for the most part, especially when it comes to being able to ban and kick and, you know, get the cheaters off. If we have that, if they work some of the issues, especially with the support class, maybe tweaking the, do the little tweaks, you know, that I'm biased. I want them to fix it the way I like it. But, in general, some of the major issues that they got, I think, like, friends list, joining off friends list and stuff like that is very clunky right now. So if they can fix some of those things to where we can join our friends easier, to where we can get on the servers that we want to play without a bunch of hassle, I think that this has the potential, and it has a potential now, to be the best Battlefield ever.
All right, Kick.
Wow.
Before we come to you, Kick, people are clamoring about battle packs real quick, so let's just talk about those really, really briefly, because I know we've gone over time a little bit. Battle packs, it's like whatever with them. I don't think the skins for the weapons are too intriguing. I just really don't care about them. I really don't understand how they're dropped during games and don't care about that. To me, they're just kind of a non-issue. Real quick, what are your all's thoughts on that? Oh?
I've been in a match where a group member was waiting the entire match and got in literally as the round was ending and won a battle pack.
Yeah, it's stupid.
Screw that guy.
Yeah. You know, and that's after I'm in the top five and doing heavy lifting, and he waited in queue and earned his battle pack. To me, they need to do some work on that system.
Yep.
I don't really mind the contents of the battle pack or the theory or thought process behind the battle pack.
Yeah.
I mean, that kind of thing, it's a nice to have. I don't need it. But holy crap,
It's infuriating when you work really, really hard to climb to the top and you do all the things you need to do and see some schmo at the very bottom who did absolutely nothing besides picking his nose on a mountain get a battle.
I have played for two straight days and not gotten a battle pack. I mean, I feel like I have a better chance of hitting a Powerball than I do of getting a battle pack. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Do you and Pun kind of agree?
Yeah, I don't get how that algorithm works. I know it's kind of somewhat random. Yeah. I think it should be tied more towards what you're doing in game than just, hey, you drew a ticket, mm-hmm. you get a cute little skin, which, by the way, could be really shitty and only get you 30 30 currency or whatever it is. Yeah. But other than that, I'm really glad that they kept them cosmetic and you can't buy them.
Yeah, right.
I think that's really cool. This is EA, and they could have easily monetized the shit out of this. They still can in the future. The fact that they chose, I know. The fact that they didn't is very promising. So good on that for keeping them cosmetic, and it's kind of cool. I mean, they're not over the top, you know, YOLO Mountain Dew, bright pink, stupid CSGO skins. These are classy.
The gold Doughboy, which I don't even have yet. All right, cool. Kickstand. Before we get your final thoughts, since you're our guest, why don't you go ahead and plug your own site and your channel? You know, give yourself the option to say who you are, what you do, and plug your channel.
Oh, thanks. What's up, guys? I'm Kickstan. A lot of you in the chat already know me. I'm mainly a Battlefield player, but I play a lot of different, mostly FPS games. You can find me at twitch.tv/Kickstan, Twitter/Kickstan, and... yeah, it's an honor. Thank you, guys. I was actually, you know, I've been in your chats and watching these podcasts, you know, before Hardline, like previous to Hardline even. So, and Pun, I've been watching your videos forever. Guys, if you have not watched Zoop's World of Warships reviews, you need to watch them. They're awesome. Historic references, context. And really good reviews on the ships. So,
I appreciate that, and I hope to bring back a real Battlefield hero at some point. There's
yes,
apparently been plenty of stuff to make fun of. So,
oh yeah.
No, seriously, your World of Warships content's awesome. I don't play that game nearly as much as I used to, and it's fun to watch. I
appreciate that. And, you know, we really want to thank you for coming on. You know, it's great having you as a guest. So hopefully we can have you on in the near future. Your thoughts on Battlefield 1?
I love it. It's if I wasn't lucky enough to get a key, I would have bought it. I don't know if I would have bought it premium right away. I just, with Hardline and the way Battlefront worked out, not that it was a fault of Hardline, it was the community that just, you know, left it after 2 months. But
unfortunately, I will say unfortunately, because that game only got better.
It's one of the best games that people don't play. It's just, I don't understand.
And it only got better because the devs actually listened to feedback and they worked hard to incorporate it. And you know, and I don't doubt that Battlefield 1, the devs poured their hearts into that game. But, you know, just from talking to Zach and the guys, they poured their hearts into that game. And I really think the product showed it. And really, and I've said it numerous times, Hardline's only failing was it came on the heels of Battlefield 4. When Battlefield 4 was still a steaming pile of poop before they fixed the issues with it and started giving away a bunch of free stuff. And I think that's why Hardline just kind of faltered. It wasn't their own fault. It was just the Battlefield 4 legacy. So,
100% agree with that.
But guys out there watching us, thanks for coming out for the podcast. It's great to be back in the saddle. We're excited. We have a lot more of these in the future. Hopefully a lot more giveaways as well. Thanks for coming out and watching us. And Bo, what you got?
And Zoop, real quick. Yeah. For everybody who's in the chat who doesn't, you know, you guys follow the DRMB channel. If you'll check out below the screen, most of our streamers, with the exception of, I think, New World Shogun, who's modding in the chat, all the links to their channels are down there. Do us all a favor. Go like our channels as well. Sometimes we do a multi-stream where we're using everybody's channel, so that would be greatly appreciated.
Give them some love, and I will say that there are big changes coming from the stream channel in the near future. We're working on trying to getting our individual streaming a lot more, so you're gonna see a lot more activity on this channel, along with podcasts and everything else. So thanks for coming out, guys. We appreciate it.
Yeah, we do.
Look forward to seeing you all in the future. Kickstand, again, thanks for coming out. Bo, Pun, as always. Yep. See you in the near future.
Do it again next week.
All right.
Next week, guys. We'll hope to see you again. Bye bye.